When you have a completed use case description, you pretty much have the blueprints for your activity diagram. You know where your start stage is, and you know what your end goal is. So let's have a look at how we go about creating the activity diagram that we've been working towards. We start off the diagram by drawing the starting stage. This is represented by a solid black circle, which is normally placed at the top centre or top left of the diagram, although the exact location isn't overly crucial. Now we can draw our first activity in the process. The activities within the activity diagram are the steps necessary to complete the content of the main and alternate flows. Activities are represented by rectangles with completely rounded edges, with the name of the activity inside. It's important too that the name of the process begins with a noun, so things like add new client, create new document, and establish connection are all perfect examples. They're very descriptive. The activities should also be positioned close together to ensure that you have enough space for your entire diagram, but not so close that the diagram looks cramped. The start position and first activity should now be connected with an arrow, specifically an arrow with an open-ended arrowhead, as opposed to a closed arrowhead, which the green arrow here has. These transition lines represent the direction that we're going to progress through the diagram, and the line should actually connect to both the start stage and the activity. There should be no gap. After the activity, we could add another activity which would involve just the same steps that we've gone through, but in this case we want to add a decision point to our diagram. Decisions are represented by a diamond shape, and we connect them from the previous step, just like a transition line from the start state to the first action, with an open-headed arrow. With decision points, we don't actually label the decision in a diamond shape. The check which resulted in the decision is in the activity above, in our case, establishing a connection. So the next thing to do is add more activities. We're either going to be able to establish a connection or we're not, and so we need two activities, and they should be both connected to the decision point. You'll notice that one of the decision points, the show error message activity, is to the side of the decision point. The position isn't too critical, but I try to separate the fact that this is part of the alternate flow, while the rest of the process will be the main flow. It's just more visual when you're using your diagram to talk to people about the process. There is one more thing that we need to do with the decision point, which is to label the two alternative paths to make it explicitly clear which path should be taken in which situation. This is done with a brief description of each alternative, which should be next to the line and inside square brackets. The description should be extremely brief, like with the names of the activities. It just describes the state the system should be in for each alternate flow to be followed. The end of the process is represented in an activity diagram by a filled circle inside an empty circle, like a bullseye or a target. This symbol is called the final state, and you can either have a single final state in your diagram, or you can have multiple. The number of final states in the diagram has no impact on the process of designing and building the system, which are the next things in the process after the system has been designed. So the only impact of having multiple final stages on your diagram is that your diagram can look cleaner because you have fewer lines going from one edge to the other. I personally tend to use many final stages in my diagrams. As I say, it tends to make your diagram look cleaner in the end result. The final state we have created doesn't mean that we have finished with our diagram. That only represents one path that the YouTube system we are describing could take, and we need to map out all of the other possible routes that the system could take if the connection is established. So let's run over each of the symbols again very quickly, and then we can take a look at the final diagram based on the use case description we've created in the last section. First up, we have the start state, which is the start of your diagram. Next we have activities, which are the actual things that happen in your system. Transition lines connect all of the elements in your diagram, and they should point to the other elements using open-headed arrows. We also have decision points, which split the process into different paths, and the transition lines leading from the decision points must be labels, and those labels must be inside squared brackets. Finally, we have the final state, which is an exit point of the system. As we talked about, you can have as many exit points as you like. The only impact of having multiple exit points is how clean looking your diagram looks in the end. So let's jump back to the diagram we've been creating, which I've gone ahead and completed. As you can see, the process is very straightforward. We perform a series of checks, and if we pass all of those checks, we upload the file. If at any point we fail one of the checks, the process comes to an end. You can also see how easy it is to identify which of the actions are performed as part of the alternatives flow, because they're not in line with the actions which are performed as part of the main flow. And as I said earlier, this can be very powerful when you're discussing the process, especially with someone who isn't as necessarily as familiar with the system as you are. But what if we don't want our process to end just because one of the checks failed? What if we want to give our user the opportunity to correct their mistakes? We don't need to finish the entire process just because we don't pass one of the tests first time. We can go back a step or two in the process instead. If you think about any time you make a purchase online and you've made a mistake with your shipping details or billing details, you didn't have to start the entire process again from scratch. You were most likely told that there was a mistake, how to fix it, and given the opportunity to fix it straight away. It's really easy to move back to a previous step instead of ending the process. Instead of having an arrow pointing to a finished state, that arrow could point to the step that you want to move back to. In this version, we've replaced the finished states with redirections to the previous step. If we follow this process through now, if the user didn't pass the test, they could see an error message and then be asked to import the data again straight away. So we've basically created a series of loops, which will only stop when the user has provided all of the correct information. An important thing to note here is that if we were to actually make this change in a real world system, we would also need to revisit both the use case description and the use case diagram documents, and make any changes to those documents as well to ensure that the changes are reflected in those systems as well. Remember, this is a series of documents all relating to the same system, and so they all need to tell the same story no matter where you start reading the story from. There's one more element involved with the activity diagrams which we've not used yet, and that's called a swim lane. Swim lanes are how we represent who is responsible for performing each activity, and if you remember our use case descriptions and our use case diagrams, you'll remember that we listed our actors in each of those diagrams. We should finish this section up by adding this information into our diagram, and it's extremely easy to do. I'll be switching back to this version of our diagram with multiple finish states here too, just in the interest of consistency. We haven't changed the other diagrams to reflect our loops after all. Swim lanes are represented on activity diagrams by rectangles aligned in accordance with your diagram. So in this case, we've drawn our diagram from top to bottom, and so the swim lane will be portrait. While if we positioned our diagram horizontally, left to right, we would align our swim lanes to be landscape as well. As well as the main rectangle, we also add the name of the actor responsible for the swim lane to the top in a miniature rectangle of its own, just like the way we have the viewer and YouTube in this example. Assigning activities to each rectangle is as simple as positioning each activity such that it is within the rectangle belonging to the appropriate owner. If the viewer does something, they are the owner, and so the activity must belong in their swim lane. If YouTube does something else, they are the owner, and the activity belongs in their swim lane. You can see from this version that the swim lane doesn't necessarily flow in one direction. The direction of a transition arrow has no impact on a system at all. It can be pointing up, down, left or right. All are just connecting the two activities that they are connected to, and indicating which order those activities should be performed. I also just want to point out something about decisions. You'll notice that all of the decisions are within the YouTube swim lane in this example. While there will of course be decisions that users need to make, Decisions about the process itself are almost always owned by the system and not by the user. This is because even if we ask the user to do something, the system is always going to double check that it has been done. Because as a system designer, you should never rely completely on checks performed by your users. It's far too easy for a user to forget or to get distracted and therefore miss a check. If you build a check into the system, there's no chance that the computer is going to forget to perform it or get distracted with something else.